There have been some wild highlights to start the season, including Grant Williams busting right through his shoe with superhuman force. But what about all of the high IQ plays? These are some of the best passes, reads, and play calls of the early 2023 season. Let's start in Oklahoma City, where the Thunder were in the midst of a wild comeback against the Bucks, trying to tie the game or take the lead. And Josh Giddey grabbed not one, but two offensive rebounds in the final minute to keep the play alive. And then they stopped the clock to see if the shot clock should have reset. And if you go back a few weeks in a preseason game, Giddey was inbounding and his coach Mark Dagnall called a simple play for a back screen to the basket, and San Antonio looks like they guard it perfectly fine, but Giddey has other ideas and slings a fastball that is an unbelievable one-handed zip. So what do they call up in that clutch situation against the Bucks? The same play, a little back screen for Lou Dort, and watch Giddey. Giddey looks to his left to inbound it, but what he really wants is Lou Dort to cut back door, reads Brook Lopez, who isn't watching the play, so he just slings a fastball with one hand back door. Tie game. Absolutely amazing passing by Josh Giddey in a clutch situation. Speaking of clutch situations, it wouldn't be a smartest plays of the month without sneaking in a Nikola Jokic doozy, and this one is in the final minute against the Thunder. Jokic is backing down and Shai Gilgeous-Alexander lingers a little on the block to provide extra help, and he even has his arms out, but Jokic doesn't care, fires a bullet for a layup to tie the game. And the brilliance of this pass to me is that Jokic's head is turned, so he maybe can see his teammate Aaron Gordon out of the corner of his eye when he picks the dribble up. And if Gordon were covered as he's swinging his arm to pass, he would just skip it into the corner for three instead. And we know this because we've seen Jokic do this repeatedly in the last few seasons. Amazing. Passes in the final minute are one thing, but I really love passes in the final second, where it looks like there isn't enough time to even pass in the first place. We saw this last season from Marcus Smart when he hit Jason Tatum at the end of a playoff game, passing it with under 2 seconds left on the clock. In Los Angeles, the Pacers run this nice little out-of-bounds action that creates confusion for the Lakers. Anthony Davis wants a switch, but Russell Westbrook follows the cutter into the corner. That leaves one Laker to guard two Pacers, and when Matt Ryan chases Buddy Hield around the screen, Miles Turner can pop wide open for three to win the game, but he leaves it short, and on the ricochet, it ends up in Tyrese Halliburton's hands, and he checks the clock, and there's only 4 seconds, so naturally, he puts it on the deck, heads right for the game-winning shot, but passes at the last second again with under 2 seconds on the clock for a game-winning three from rookie Andrew Nembhard. And he said after the game that he didn't hit Buddy Hield in the strong side corner because Anthony Davis was lurking to block the shot, so he swung it to the other side instead. An incredibly heady and unselfish pass from Halliburton, and just reinforces you can pass the ball in the final seconds of the game. Let's stick with more endgame drama. In Cleveland, the Celtics and Cavs played one of the best games of the young season, and it was close down the stretch, and the Cavs want to screen Evan Mobley here to make it a little harder to defend his screen on the ball, but notice the Celtics pre-switch this by keeping Al Horford low. So that means Horford is guarding Donovan Mitchell, and that's a mismatch the Cavs want. So Mitchell wisely clears out wide to the corner so no other Celtic can get near him to switch back. Then he wants to cut back into this open space so the Celtics can't switch, gets it with the floor cleared out, immediately attacks the mismatch, and finishes to go up 4. There were, of course, more dramatics in this game. With the Celtics down 2 and 10 seconds left, they set up this really tricky inbounds play where Jason Tatum is in the backcourt. And with a defender glued to him, the first option that gives Boston is the ability to play 4-on-4, which makes it easier. Instead, what they really want here is Tatum coming downhill with some momentum. if he heads left, that means Mitchell can just switch onto him. So what he really wants to do is set up his man, Dean Wade, to cut back to the right like a football wide receiver. Tatum catches it in open space, and here's where the second part of that play design is so powerful. By Al Horford sprinting to the corner, the natural helping defender here becomes this low man in the opposite corner, but he's worried about Jaylen Brown coming off some screening action. Evan Mobley doesn't want to leave the strong side corner because Horford would be wide open, and it's Jared Allen who has to come all the way over from the inbounds position to try to save the play. He can't, it's a Tatum dunk, and the Celtics sent the game into overtime. Brilliant play design by rookie coach Joe Mazzulla. There have been some next level passes early in the season, and one trend to keep an eye out for is players driving to the hoop, realizing there's a lob threat, and just throwing it up near the rim when they're not able to finish. I don't know if Jason Tatum actually intended to do that here, or if the ball was blocked, but on this play in Chicago, the ageless Goran Dragic certainly intended it, as he came blazing off a screen, turned the corner to get downhill, met a shot blocker, and realized he could just throw it up in the air for his role man, and that is an absolutely incredible pass and finish by Derrick Jones Jr. This one wasn't a lob, but it was certainly next level. De'Aaron Fox comes off an early pick here, tries to get left downhill against the Golden State defense, and when Andrew Wiggins comes over to help, the corner pass is open. So what does this help defender do? He slides toward the corner. So Fox moves to his second read, which is to throw it to the wing, and Jordan Poole knows he needs to then rotate to the wing. So Fox just throws it right where Poole left, and that leaves a wide open runway for Chimezie Metu and a huge dunk. And again, the normal pass here from Fox is probably the corner. The second level pass is to the wing, and he plays some 4D chess to throw it all the way back to his original screener. Amazing. Trae Young can play a similar game too. This is down the stretch against the Pelicans, and Zion Williamson is switched on to Trae here, so he's able to use his quickness and attack him. Once he's in the paint, can use that incredible passing to find teammates. After a Pelicans bucket cut it to three, they ended up with Brandon Ingram switched on to Trae. He again wants the clear out, drives into the paint, and for the second straight possession, uses that little floater pass to punish the help and keep the Hawks ahead. So finally, Herb Jones says, "I am not switching off of Trae no matter what." Young asks for the screen, and Herb says, "I am getting over it." Ingram stays in his path until Jones completely recovers, and this way the Pelicans don't give up the switch. So they try the screen again with six on the shot clock. Ingram jumps Trae, and as Herb recovers, that leaves the screener open at the top. This help defender realizes that with 3 seconds left, as Young is going to pass it to him. So Trae goes next level and throws it right at his man in the corner, and it's a wide open three to ice the game. Spectacular. Finally, the Kings have run some beautiful offense this season. For instance, they ran different wrinkles on the same play against the Clippers earlier this year, starting a guard in the paint during pick and roll, and then having him pop out here for an uncontested three. That's a tricky action to guard, so they come back to it a few minutes later. Kevin Huerter goes and sits down in the paint. De'Aaron Fox runs the pick and roll toward the middle, and this time Huerter sneaks out the other side, unselfishly makes the extra pass, and it's a wide open three for Fox. So they'll use cutters in creative ways like this, and watch Huerter on this one, guarded by Steph Curry. He looks like he might cut through to the other side, or when he sits in the paint, pop out to the top of the key again, but instead he sprints to the corner around a little baseline screen. The Warriors jump on the cut, and that leaves our old friend Metu wide open. And the thing I love about this play is we've seen Steph Curry make this same cut over and over again over the years and pull defenders with him through his gravitational orbit. And this time, Huerter was the one who gave Curry a taste of his own medicine. You see Steph turn and realize what happened, and all he can do is give a round of applause and say touché. So those were the smartest plays of the first half of the season. Now let's look at the second half. Well, remember that out-of-bounds play at the end of the Boston-Cleveland game that got Tatum a dunk? In a critical game in March in Philadelphia, the Celtics found themselves in a similar situation, tied in the final few seconds, and Coach Joe Mazzulla went back to that same play design. With Tatum in the backcourt, Horford brings his man over to the far corner, and Jaylen Brown's going to clear out the paint. So it's the same setup, Smart catches it, Tatum gets to the right like he wants into open space, but this time Joel Embiid leaves Derek White, who's wide open, so Tatum slams on the brakes because of that traffic in the lane, peels it back for a pull-up three to take the lead with 1 second left. Philadelphia has no timeouts left, so all they can do is set up a desperation heave, and Joel Embiid tries one from 80 feet and swishes it, but it was after the buzzer, so the Celtics hold on with that familiar play design to take one in Philly. Speaking of callbacks, in the smartest plays from 2022, I talked about another timeout play diagram where Denver vacates the paint to set up a little Nikola Jokic, Aaron Gordon pick and roll, and the Nuggets like to run different versions of this play. Here's Jokic zipping up off a little screen to catch it on the move. The screener again is going to clear out to the corner to vacate the paint. That means the second Aaron Gordon gets this screen, he turns inside and rolls into open space, and it's very difficult to defend with a passer like Jokic. So, in game two of the Western Conference Finals, the Nuggets go to it after a timeout. Jokic comes off two screens at the foul line area. They know the Lakers don't want to switch, so Anthony Davis chases him out there. And this time they have Aaron Gordon come from the block to set the screen to set up the pick and roll. Notice how the shooters are out of the paint, so there's a ton of space for Gordon to roll into. The only problem here is they're playing LeBron James, who knows the play and is looking for that lob, even on a bum ankle, can get up and deflect the lob pass, break up the play, and then that springs a Los Angeles fast break where LeBron ends up getting free throws on the other end. And this is an incredible defensive read from James, who smells it early by not chasing Gordon out too hard, and as Jokic comes off the pick, he basically plays the pass instead of a shot, and that saves the day on that play for the Lakers. Anthony Davis can be an absolute nightmare for defenses, setting a pick and then rolling down the lane. Davis is one of the best lob finishers in NBA history, that ability to go up and over the top even when the defender is there, and his size and touch coming downhill can make him a real problem for defenses. So teams tried more extreme coverages during the season against him. Maybe the most extreme was what Toronto did in this March matchup, with OG Anunoby never really wanting to pick up the ball handler and leave Davis on these pick and roll actions. And even when Anunoby dropped back, he's really not thinking about the ball handler. The Raptors can bring a third defender over to the foul line here, but Anunoby is really worried about staying with Davis to take away that roll game, which freed up opportunities for the ball handlers. And this was pretty extreme at times, with OG hugging Anthony Davis and making no effort to get in front of Austin Reeves here. So that set up a little sequence in the second quarter where D'Angelo Russell comes off the screen, slows up and looks to the wing to move that third defender back to the shooter, and then he keeps dribbling down the paint, and when help comes, Russell can kick it to the corner for a wide open three. But that's just the hors d'oeuvre, because the entree is a minute later with Davis setting an early screen for Russell. He goes to the in and out dribble to get downhill, and because he knows Anunoby doesn't want to leave Davis, he slows up to fake a pass back to him. That's all it takes to get a wide open layup. That is a beautiful high IQ play by Russell to manipulate the defense. When Luka Doncic is in pick and roll, he likes to throw these behind the back passes to his screener, who pops out to the outside. So in this early game situation against Houston, he snakes into the paint against Alperen Şengün and blends that behind the back dribble back to the shooter. And that's not the greatest pass from Luka, and that's okay because he's just setting up the defense for the same situation a few minutes later. Doncic calls for the screen from Christian Wood, Şengün comes up into the same situation, Luka again slows down the dribble, fakes the behind-the-back pass which sends Şengün flying, and Luka can take it in for an easy two. That one was nice, but this one might have been better with pick-and-roll maestro Trae Young operating with an entire empty side of the floor to work with. So Cleveland needs to send a defender over to help on the roll man in this situation. And Young knows that, so when he sets up the pick-and-roll, he slows down and fakes the pocket pass. Lamar Stevens thinks there's no more threat, but Young is setting up a no-look lob on the money, and that is absolute perfection. A second ago on that D'Angelo Russell pick and roll, we saw a little pin-in screen where Hachimura screened for the corner shooter so his man couldn't get out to him. But one trend that is becoming more popular is screening your own man in these situations instead. Al Horford sprints over to the corner to set a screen for Jason Tatum, but he's actually popping to the outside, and Tatum just ends up screening off his own man on the play, so Horford is left with a ton of space for this wide open shot. And this tactic is successful because it's a counter to a switch. Klay Thompson is flying under the hoop here, and he's telling Draymond Green to set that little pin-in screen for him to screen Devin Booker. But Booker points to switch, so Chris Paul is just going to step out anyway, and Draymond brilliantly adjusts by screening his own man Paul. Klay Thompson could make a sandwich, he has so much time, and that's like a layup for him. You can even do this in the paint. The Bucks love to set a foul line area screen to spring Giannis downhill. Here he gets kind of stuck and passes it to himself off the backboard, but that doesn't count because it's from 2022. Although in this incredible March game against the Kings this season, Sacramento was just switching Giannis's pick and rolls, which largely neutered the power of these actions. Bobby Portis comes up to set the screen on Giannis's man, and Trey Lyles just switches and the play goes nowhere. So later in the game, when they run the same inverted pick and roll, Portis knows that Sacramento wants to switch. So as he comes to set the screen, instead of picking Giannis's man, he turns and squares off against his own defender. That kills the ability to switch successfully, gets Giannis going downhill, and he's too big for the smaller defenders in the paint. During the finals, Jamal Murray and Nikola Jokic's two-man game gave Miami fits. So in game four, they started trapping Murray a lot in these actions. And Miami's idea here was to double Murray and take away the pass to Jokic. So with Kevin Love already shifted over, Jokic tells Gordon to flash to the high post as an outlet valve. And after the whistle, he goes over to explain how to counter the trapping scheme. So later in the quarter, when they trap Murray again, that nearest defender slides to Jokic, and this time Gordon does flash middle, sucking in the defense and setting up a wide open Bruce Brown three. And this teaching lesson came full circle a minute later when Miami trapped Murray. Bam's length made it hard to hit Jokic, so he flashes to the middle, which occupies Butler, and KCP throws a great lob over the top to Gordon, capping some brilliant countermeasures from the Nuggets against the Heat. And finally, Greg Popovich has called up some incredible plays over the years as part of his brilliant Hall of Fame coaching career. And this one late in the season against the Mavs with 2 seconds to play may have been my favorite all year. The Spurs are anticipating that Dallas will probably switch every screen. So they set up 2 staggered screens for this shooter in the corner, anticipating this switch. And because this action is so common in the NBA, Reggie Bullock is calling for the second defender to jump out and switch onto the shooter as he curls around. But if we go back to the beginning of the play, Trey Jones comes off this first screen into the corner, so now there are no players remaining in the paint, which means that when Bullock calls for that switch, Keldon Johnson can slip the screen and run into open space for a lob to tie the game. And this is just a brilliant play design because it's even hard for Bullock to switch and help in the paint because he wants to get inside of this big man for a similar situation. And it puts a ton of pressure on this defender, Maxi Kleba, to perfectly read the situation. He doesn't, and the Spurs send the game into overtime thanks to the brilliance of the Hall of Famer, Greg Popovich. You can get Thinking Basketball content in the NBA app throughout the season. And if you want more right now, check out the Thinking Basketball channel on YouTube.